welcome to this Friday's edition of Coronavirus Facts versus Myths. India's cases continue to surge, but that's not our only worry. Vaccinations have hit a 10-day low, with only 22 lakh doses being administered in the last 24 hours. What's worse, Delhi, Maharashtra, Punjab, Rajasthan, Tamil Nadu, Madhya Pradesh, Kerala, Karnataka, among other states, say that they can't begin vaccinating the 18-plus population from tomorrow because they have no stock. Mumbai has closed vaccinations for all adults for 3 days due to the shortage. Now, the case positivity rate in India has surged past 20%. Bengal, which recently saw the election, Uttarakhand, which recently saw the Kumbh, are two states that have reported the biggest surge in the last 24 hours. These are all extremely worrying developments that are taking place. But to make sense of what really is happening in India currently, we have with us noted epidemiologist Professor Giridhar Babu. Thanks so much for joining us. I want to begin by asking you about the positivity rate. In terms of numbers, a 20% positivity rate, what does this mean for our fight against COVID?
Thanks, Rishika, for having me on this show. In India, as per the global standards prescribed by WHO, we should have a test positivity of 5% or less. That means that the epidemic is under control and we are testing enough and the infection is not spreading to many people. The only way to achieve 5% or below is by having everybody who is suspected to have COVID-19 tested. So this only happens when the syndromic approach is really strong and the testing rates are really adequate. When both of these are deficient and we are not finding enough people to test, then the test positivity keeps increasing. So an increasing test positivity means either the infection is really widespread, so whomever you are testing is turning out to be positive. Number second is the number of tests that we are doing for detecting are far too low. So a combination of these two will have higher test positivity.
Right. In India at the moment, what do you reckon? I mean, we know that the infection is spreading widely. There have been over 3 lakh cases for 9 straight days. But we are also seeing that there's been a dip in testing, whether it's national testing or whether it's certain states that are reporting a dip in testing.
So there is some amount of decrease in testing in all the places, but some places have greater decrease in number of tests done. Of particular concern is the states with increasing effective reproduction number. So to give you an explanation, effective reproduction number means how many people are getting infected from one infected person. The moment you decrease the test, even the RT falls, the reproduction number. Uttar Pradesh and Bihar have fewer tests done. Similarly, there are other states in the northern India which are decreasing the test, and also not just the number of tests, the kind of test that we do, RT-PCR versus the RAT, this is also important to monitor.
Right. I want to also ask you specifically about two states, West Bengal, which recently saw the election. We saw large crowds gather during the course of the campaign, even during the course of polling. Uttarakhand, which just saw the Kumbh Mela. These are two states in the last 24 hours that have reported the largest ever rise in COVID cases. Was this something that was anticipated? Will the impact of these large crowds now be felt over the coming weeks?
The testing during the election phase or super spreader events may not be as to the expected level that one would want to see. So when these super spreader events are over, whether it is elections or Kumbh Mela or any other religious congregations, and once the testing rates come back to normalcy, you will see increased test positivity. West Bengal has a positivity rate of 27.8%, which is really concerning given the kind of health systems capacity in the West Bengal, especially in the remote and rural areas. How is the state going to cope up with the increased cases, especially the critical care needs? How are this, these states, especially even Uttarakhand, how is it going to cater, is of really concerning issue now.
And you talked about, testing dipping in several parts, and that is a cause of concern. And that's also one of the reasons you're saying that the positivity rate has gone up. Why, according to you, Professor Babu, at a time when India's cases are surging, is our testing dipping?
This is an interesting question. So there are two ways of containing the pandemic. One, you find out every person whom you think might have COVID, test and isolate. This is the only way to contain the transmission. It is difficult. It requires a lot of effort from the health workers. It requires a lot of testing to be done. On the other hand, there is fear, there is panic, there is also probably some places where active efforts are done to decrease the amount of testing, thereby have fewer cases reflected in their overall scenario. This is very difficult to distinguish which are these areas unless a detailed review is done.
All right. Well, you know, the other worrying story, so testing is dipping. The positivity rate in the country is soaring. We've seen 9 straight days of over 3 lakh infections. But tomorrow is supposed to be a momentous day when India opens up vaccination for those above the age of 18. However, instead, what we're seeing happen is that there are several states that are now reporting a shortage of vaccinations, saying that the next phase of the vaccination drive cannot begin tomorrow because of a shortage. What's worse is that our national vaccination in the last 24 hours has also seen a 10-day low. To make sense of what's happening as far as the vaccine story is concerned, we also have with us Dr. Sushila Kataria, Senior Director, Internal Medicine, joining us from the Medanta Hospital, and Dr. Shweta Khandelwal, the Head of Nutrition Research at the Public Health Foundation of India. Thank you both very much for joining us as well. Professor Babu continues to be with us. Dr. Kataria, if I can begin by asking you, vaccine shortage is being reported across several states. They say they just don't have the supply to begin vaccinating those above the age of 18. How big a setback is this?
Definitely, when we're going through such a big, huge surge in number of cases, it is posing double trouble. So one, that we do not have the luxury of the time because the infection is spreading at a faster rate. So to combat that, we need to vaccinate even faster. But now with everything, there is always a gap between the demand and supply, which is more evident right now. So far, the vaccinated population was very limited and the government had enough vaccines and there was a lot of surplus supply with the manufacturers also. So that was doing it. But now lots and lots of people are registering, and from 1st of May, the demand for vaccine would increase. But there is so much of unclarity. I work in a tertiary care level hospital, which is a private hospital. So till now, the government was supplying us. We were administering and we vaccinated more than, you know, lakh of people. And we are ready to vaccinate even more. Mm. But where is the vaccine? We do not have clarity. If we ask the manufacturer to give us, they say we already have advance orders from the government, which we have to fulfill before we can take up your orders. So, and you know, people keep on asking questions, is Sputnik going to come? Are you having that vaccine? So we do not have any vaccine available right now, which we have procured ourselves. And we do not know how to do that. So there is a lot of uncertainty. And obviously, I think that program, which is to be started on 1st of May, will have to take a backseat because of the non-availability of vaccine. So that's the only limiting factor. We have enough infrastructure to vaccinate as many as possible in all age groups.
All right. And in fact, it's being reflected in the numbers as well. There's been a dip in vaccination at a time. And let me bring in Dr. Shweta Khandelwal here as well. At a time when we've moved from hesitancy to almost a certain level of desperation, people now looking at the number of cases want to get the vaccine, want to get any, you know, and every protection that they can get from this surge of COVID. What we're essentially seeing is a shortfall. Several states now saying that they can't live up to the commitment or expand the ambit of vaccination starting from the 1st of May. The center at this point, the health ministry has asked vaccination centers to return the unused stock as well. What's the rationale of this?
So I think what we are reading and hearing is that by 5 o'clock today, whatever vaccines are being left are supposed to be returned to the center to maybe have a restock of how much is available and, you know, do these calculations, etc. But what I want to bring to the notice is that there are several key issues here which we need to understand. Number one is the limitation of having only two players in the market currently to provide vaccines in a country of 1.3 billion, where many more players can be and should be roped in using indigenous capacity building exercises. So that's number one. If we had more players open, this would not be the case. We would not be running out of stocks like this, and at a time, like you rightly said, where the need is the most, is at the highest. The second thing which is important is that there is no proper documentation or clarity in terms of private players and the government institutes as well, because we do not know after 5 o'clock what happens tomorrow. How many states are rolling it out? Some of them are saying in desperation, we don't have it, we will not roll it out. So this is creating even a stronger panic amongst people who are registering and who thought that vaccination is a hopeful strategy was something which was being able to help them come out of the surge, this COVID massive surge. And if we see this kind of lack of clarity and no documentation at all so far from the government showing this clearly as to what the plan and transparently the strategy is, This is really not a very good sign, I must say. So we must need to, of course, take stock, and This is happening maybe in bits and pieces, but consolidate this urgently. Comprehensive plan of strategy should be out, keeping the red zones, the people who are most stuck, and the people who are with comorbidity at a higher priority.
Yes. And at this moment, there's also uncertainty over, the second dose, and if it gets delayed, what happens? And we'll address that question in just a moment. But Professor Babu, I want to understand from you, what we saw happen in the UK, for instance, where the UK variant spread very rapidly. We are seeing a very similar pattern repeat itself in India. The way we understand the UK did it is that they had a national lockdown, which was a very strict lockdown, and a very high rate of vaccination. Currently, neither of the two strategies is being implemented in India. There is localized lockdowns that are taking place, and we're running short of vaccine. How do you anticipate this to impact our numbers?
You have summarized it really well, Rishika. So UK does 10% of their weekly samples for genomic sequencing. We need to step up the genomic sequencing as we are expanding the surveillance network. We need to understand how these vaccines that we have are effective against the indigenous and the imported variants. Most importantly, wherever required, we need to have aggressive containment measures, including strict lockdown. Lockdowns are necessary to reduce the speed of transmission and also to get our resources together, redistribute, and ensure that many lives are saved. Even now, I see that many areas of the country have in desperate need of oxygen. We only report Delhi, Bangalore, or Mumbai, mostly because people are tracking this. I'm certain that there are many other areas where we are unable to track it so well as in Delhi or Bangalore.
Right. I also want to ask you, Dr. Kataria, this is a question that we've been asking and, asking for doctors like yourselves to give clarity to our viewers. There is some level of insecurity over the second dose. Many people who've taken their first dose waiting for the second. Now, with the news of the vaccine shortage being reported in several states, what happens if the second dose is delayed?
So I think what has already been summarized that, there is not much clarity on what will happen. But I would like to assure that I'm not too much worried about little delay in the second dose. Vaccines are, it's never like that it has to be given on 28th day or it has to be given on the 42nd day. It can be delayed little bit. A delayed vaccine is better than no vaccine at all. And with a Covishield, I would further say if it is delayed for 2 months or 3 months, it might produce even better antigenicity or better protection. So don't be worried, don't be hurried, and don't be in a panic if you're second dose is getting delayed by a few weeks. That's okay. It's okay to take it little delayed.
Right.
It is not like a sharp one time, but to have is important. So we should have a plan that, okay, we can't give it on 4 weeks. The Covaxin, let's give it in 8 weeks, or let's give the Covishield in 12 weeks. But I think there has to be some plan, some stock of the situation needs to be taken.
Yes, and I think
so,
Dr. Kataria, more importantly,
vaccinated. These are second dose and these are first dose.
Yes.
This will be our pace of vaccination, and we need to, as I said, we need to have more players. Let's ask for everybody to help. in import.
No, and I think I'm gonna just briefly interrupt you there, because I think you raise a very important point when you say that this clarity needs to be issued. So if Covaxin can be given up to 6 weeks or 8 weeks, the government needs to clarify on that, or the manufacturers need to clarify. And Covishield, as we know, anyway has a 6 to 8 week window. In the UK, we already know that it is even being given after 12 weeks. But that clarity needs to be given to people, because there is a lot of confusion over what happens if the second dose does in fact get delayed. We're going to slip into a very short break at this moment, but our panel of expert doctors will continue to be live with us. On the other side, we'll take your questions on COVID-19. The number there flashing on your screens. Dial us with your questions. We'll have them answered. Stay with us. Welcome back. Our panel of expert doctors continues to be live with us on Coronavirus Facts versus Myths. We have our first caller, Aditya, dialing in from Kolkata. Go ahead.
Yeah, I just had the question that my grandfather, who is aged 97, and my aunt, who is in her early 50s, both have tested positive yesterday. So, like, my grandfather is not willing to get hospitalized right now because the symptoms are mild with little fever and a little bit of cough. The SpO2 level is over 90 till now. So do we require immediate hospitalization for him because of his age, or we'll just wait and watch?
All right. Dr. Kataria, would you like to take that?
Okay. So I missed some part. How much is the oxygen saturation?
The oxygen is okay, he said.
Pardon?
I said, I think he said the oxygen is okay.
Okay. So I think he has brought a very, very important question, and that takes care of the management of milder cases. All those people who have normal oxygen saturation should be at home at this juncture, especially because not to overburden the healthcare facilities. The only red flag signs would be if the oxygen saturation is 94 or less, persistent high-grade fever beyond 7 days, poor oral intake, confusional state, or any blood in sputum or something.
Right.
Otherwise, please stay at home, take symptomatic control, hydrate yourself well. And I think that's the way forward. We have to manage all mild, even to some extent, some moderate cases at home. Then only we'll be able to decongest. So your patient would be doing fine. We wish them a speedy recovery. Please stay at home. Right now, no admission required.
Well, yes. And we all join Dr. Kataria, Aditya, in wishing your family a speedy recovery. Bilal from Srinagar is our next caller.
Hello.
Yes, go ahead.
Good afternoon. This is Bilal Ahmed speaking from Srinagar.
Go ahead.
I had recently tested positive, and after 14 days of quarantine, I have tested negative for this COVID disease. Thanks to God. And may I ask the doctor that after how many days a person can opt for the vaccination when a person is tested negative for this COVID?
Okay.
Recently, besides the second part of this, my question is, when a person, there's a general perception that is spread in the society because since this is a new disease, there's no much research that has happened in the past year.
Right. What's your question?
When a person is affected, impacted, or attacked by this COVID disease, a general perception in the society is that there are some beyond repair, there are some the internal organs, the damage that has happened to them, they are beyond repairs.
Okay.
So how far is it correct?
All right. I'll take that question to Dr. Khandelwal. Dr. Khandelwal, two questions. One, of course, is when can he take the vaccine if he's just tested negative after 14 days? And second is, you know, to what extent does COVID damage your body and how can you come to know?
So I think a medical doctor will be in a better position, Rashika, to answer this question. I'll pass it on to Dr. Kataria.
Dr. Kataria, would you like to take that on?
I would like to pitch in. So vaccination after somebody who has been infected, if it is a milder case and got better at home only, then 1 month post recovery.
Okay.
And if somebody has been very severe or moderately sick patients, in that case, it has been found the antibodies are good to protect for 3 months. So they can delay it 3 months. And it is also very important right now to judiciously use the vaccines. The reinfection rates are very low. So let us give the vaccines to those who have not been infected rather than those who have been infected. So those who have been infected can delay the vaccine some time.
Okay.
To his second question, there is a lot of worry and fear and to some extent paranoia in the society that it will damage the organs permanently. Majority of the patients may be left with some anxieties, insomnias for some time who are mild to moderate. But all the organs, including the lungs of all those patients who have been even in ICU and got on ventilator and got better, the lungs are recovering nicely. It may take 3 months, it may take 6 months, but all of the people will have lead a normal life after recovery. The time would be affected, maybe 3 to 6 months.
Right. Professor Babu, is there anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, as per the Government of India guidelines, any person who is completely recovered can take the vaccine 4 to 8 weeks after the recovery. WHO has different guidance on this. They say 6 months after recovery.
Right.
But in any case, as Dr. Kataria said, people should wait for some time after their recovery.
All right. So if you've had a mild case, then 1 month is in fact enough. Mahesh from Bengaluru is our next caller. Go ahead.
Hello. Good afternoon, sir. Madam. I'm speaking from Mangalore. What I wanted to ask is, I had a COVID infection during September last year, and I had a Covaxin during the beginning of this month, April. And what my question is, can I take vitamin C and zinc in a long interval, like alternative days, to have some precaution? Because as I will be moving around for some tasks every day, is it necessary?
All right. I think we'll also take in one more question. Priyanka dialing in from Bengaluru. Go ahead.
Yeah, hi. Good afternoon, doctors. Good afternoon, panel. So my question... are you able to hear me?
Yes, Priyanka. Go ahead. We can hear
you. Yeah. So good afternoon, everyone. So I'm calling in from Bengaluru. So I have two questions. So the first question is that as it has been prescribed to use N95 masks in preference to the cloth mask, a cotton mask. So I just wanted to know that are N95 masks reusable? Can we wash them and reuse them for a few times, or we need to dispose them after one usage? And my second question is, if we are wearing contact lenses, so how can we ensure that we don't get the lenses infected?
Okay, I'm going to take those questions very quickly. Dr. Kataria, I'm completely out of time, but prolonged use of vitamin C, zinc tablets, even after you've got the vaccine, is that recommended?
Not at all. And it does not even ensure that you will not have it. Vitamin C is water soluble, so anyway, it will not damage your system much. Even if you have taken extra, it will come out in urine. But zinc is not like that, a benign element. So overuse can be harmful. You know, the difference between drug and poison is just the quantity. So take it right and don't continue to take it. I will not suggest taking it indefinitely.
Okay. Dr. Kataria, would you like to add anything? Dr. Khandelwal, would you like to add anything?
No, just because in nutrition also, we are seeing people are having an overdrive of all these immune boosting foods or supplements and things like those. I would completely advise against those. They put your system in overdrive and it's not required, not advised.
Okay, I'm completely out of time, but reuse N95 masks, is that something that's recommended? How many times can you wash it and reuse it? Any of the doctors? Dr. Kataria?
Washing of N95 mask is not recommended, but there are some ways to disinfect it. One simplest way is that you use one mask, leave it for 5 days and then reuse it after 5 days because the surface and the sunlight would take care of it. In the medical scenario, we have some infrareds and some other ways to decontaminate. This is to be done when there is a limited supply of the N95 mask. We did a lot in the beginning of the pandemic. Now, fortunately, there is enough supply. We just... either continue to use it for 1 or 2 days and then dispose it off.
Okay.
But yes, don't wash it. Washing may damage it.
All right. Washing may actually damage it. Very useful advice. I'm afraid I'm completely out of time. Thank you so much, doctors, for sparing your time, being with us on NDTV. It's been an extremely interesting conversation. As far as the vaccination is concerned, well, it's a story we'll continue to track very closely. That's all we have time for on the show today. Thanks for watching.